Penguin Random House Audio presents The Creative Act, A Way of Being, written and read for you by Rick Rubin. The object isn't to make art, it's to be in that wonderful state which makes art inevitable. Robert Henry.
Nothing in this book is known to be true. It's a reflection on what I've noticed. Not facts so much as thoughts. Some ideas may resonate, others may not. A few may awaken an inner knowing you forgot you had. Use what's helpful, let go of the rest. Each of these moments is an invitation to further inquiry, looking deeper, zooming out, or in, opening possibilities for a new way of being. Everyone is a creator. Those who do not engage in the traditional arts may be wary of calling themselves artists. They may perceive creativity as something extraordinary or beyond their capabilities, a calling for the special few who were born with these gifts. Fortunately, this is not the case. Creativity is not a rare ability. It is not difficult to access. Creativity is a fundamental aspect of being human. It's our birthright, and it's for all of us. Creativity doesn't exclusively relate to making art. We all engage in this act on a daily basis. To create is to bring something into existence that wasn't there before. It could be a conversation, a solution to a problem, a note to a friend, the rearrangement of furniture in a room, or a new route home to avoid a traffic jam. What you make doesn't have to be witnessed, recorded, sold, or encased in glass for it to be a work of art. Through the ordinary state of being, we're already creators in the most profound way, creating our experience of reality and composing the world we perceive. In each moment, we're immersed in a field of undifferentiated matter from which our senses gather bits of information. The outside universe we perceive doesn't exist as such. Through a series of electrical and chemical reactions, we generate a reality internally. We create forests and oceans, warmth and cold. We read words, hear voices, and form interpretations. Then in an instant, we produce a response. All of this in a world of our own creation. Regardless of whether or not we're formally making art, we're all living as artists. We perceive, filter, and collect data, then curate an experience for ourselves and others based on this information set. Whether we do this consciously or unconsciously, by the mere fact of being alive, we are active participants in this ongoing process of creation. To live as an artist is a way of being in the world, a way of perceiving, a practice of paying attention, refining our sensitivity to tune into the more subtle notes, looking for what draws us in and what pushes us away, noticing what feeling tones arise and where they lead. A tune choice by a tune choice, your entire life is a form of self-expression. You exist as a creative being in a creative universe, a singular work of art. Tuning in. Think of the universe as an eternal creative unfolding. Trees blossom, cells replicate, rivers forge new tributaries. The world pulses with productive energy, and everything that exists on the planet is driven by that energy. Every manifestation of this unfolding is doing its own work on behalf of the universe, each in its own way, true to its own creative impulse. Just as trees grow flowers and fruit, humanity creates works of art. The Golden Gate Bridge, The White Album, Guernica, Hagia Sophia, The Sphinx, The Space Shuttle, The Autobahn, Clair de Lune, The Roman Colosseum, The Phillips Screwdriver, The iPad, Philadelphia Cheesesteak. Look around you. There are so many remarkable accomplishments to appreciate. Each of these is humanity being true to itself, as a hummingbird is true to itself by building a nest, a peach tree by bearing fruit, and a nimbus cloud by producing rain. Every nest, every peach, every raindrop, and every great work is different. Some trees may appear to make more beautiful fruits than others, and some humans may appear to compose greater works than others. The taste and beauty are in the eye of the beholder. How does the cloud know when to rain? How does the tree know when spring begins? How does the bird know when it's time to build a new nest? The universe functions like a clock. To everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to reap, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to laugh, a time to weep, a time to build up, a time to break down, a time to dance, a time to mourn, a time to cast away stones, a time to gather stones together. These rhythms are not set by us. We are all participating in a larger creative act we are not conducting. We are being conducted. The artist is on a cosmic timetable, just like all of nature. If you have an idea you're excited about and you don't bring it to life, it's not uncommon for that idea to find its voice through another maker. This isn't because the other artist stole your idea. It's because the idea's time has come. In this great unfolding, ideas and thoughts, themes and songs, and other works of art exist in the ether and ripen on schedule, ready to find expression in the physical world. As artists, it is our job to draw down this information, transmute it, and share it. We are all translators for the messages the universe is broadcasting. The best artists tend to be the ones with the most sensitive antennae to draw in the energy resonating at a particular moment. Many great artists first develop sensitive antennae not to create, but to protect themselves. They have to protect themselves because everything hurts more. They feel everything more deeply. Often art arrives in movements. Bauhaus architecture, abstract expressionism, French New Wave cinema, punk rock, beat poetry, to name a few from recent history. These movements appear like a wave. Some artists are able to read the culture and position themselves to ride the swell. Others might see the wave and choose to swim against the current. We are all antennae for creative thought. Some transmissions come on strong, others more faint. If your antenna isn't sensitively tuned, you're likely to lose the data in the noise, particularly since the signals coming through are often more subtle than the content we collect through sensory awareness. They're energetic more than tactile, intuitively perceived more than consciously recorded. Most of the time, we're gathering data from the world through the five senses. With the information being transmitted on higher frequencies, we're channeling energetic material that can't be physically grasped. It defies logic in the same way that an electron can be in two places at once. This elusive energy is of great worth, though so few people are open enough to hold it. How do we pick up on a signal that can neither be heard nor defined? The answer is not to look for it, nor do we try to predict or analyze our way into it. Instead, we create an open space that allows it, a space so free of the normal, overpacked condition of our minds that it creates a vacuum, drawing down the ideas that the universe is making available. This freedom is not as difficult to achieve as one might think. We all start with it. As children, we experience much less interference between receiving ideas and internalizing them. We accept new information with delight instead of making comparisons to what we already believe. We live in the moment rather than worrying about future consequences. We are spontaneous more than analytical. We are curious, not jaded. Even the most ordinary experiences in life are met with a sense of awe. Deep sadness and intense excitement can come within moments of each other.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.